Welcome. We'll call to order the March 16, 2017 business meeting, and Don Krupp, our county administrator, will take a roll.
Well, good evening, Mr. Chair, commissioners, and it's a beautiful evening tonight, I think. So it appears that maybe winter is on its way out, and spring may be finally coming and arriving. We'll see. I'm going to acknowledge we have County Council Stephen Madkour here this evening, and Clerk of the Board Mary Rathke here as well. I'll do the roll. Commissioner Humberston?
Here.
Commissioner Fisher?
Here.
Commissioner Reynolds?
Here.
Commissioner Schrader?
Here.
Commissioner Savas?
You're here.
Chair Bernard?
Here. With that, please join me in a Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Okay, with that, we're going to adjourn as the Board of County Commissioners and convene as the Housing Authority Board for the next item. Mr. Reynolds is the commissioner. You may have wondered why there were six of us. You don't remember voting that. He's the Housing Authority Commissioner. Paul?
Thank you.
And with that, we'll move on to, I guess you introduce that, don't you?
Yes, Mr. Chair, we have a public hearing for the Housing Authority. It's on the proposed 2017-2022 Housing Authority of Clackamas County annual and five-year plan. We have Mr. Chuck Robbins here to present this item to you. Chuck?
Good evening, Commissioners. Chair Bernard. Don and Mary, happy to be here tonight. I'm Chuck Robbins. I'm the Executive Director of the Housing Authority of Clackamas County. This is an annual public hearing that we hold on our plan, and there's a couple housekeeping things that HUD asked me to do, so bear with me as I kind of walk through this, and then we'll open it up. So you've got a copy in your packet of our five-year plan. There's three primary elements of this. It's of the public hearing, and that requires a review of last year's performance of the Section 8 Public Housing and Capital Grants Program, a review of the proposed five-year plan, and an opportunity for citizens to testify on the plan looking at public housing needs and performance. So this plan, as I should say, you know, was prepared by staff, but it has been reviewed by our resident advisory board. This is made up of residents of Section 8 and public housing. This was done on January 19th, and it's been out for public comment between January 21st and March 7th. We haven't received any public comments at that point. I also need to say that there's no action that the board needs to take today on this plan. This is just an opportunity to kind of talk about what's in the plan, answer questions, take public testimony. We'll take whatever testimony we receive, make any changes that we need to in the plan, and then we will resubmit the plan for approval at a special April 6th meeting. So let me just kind of quickly talk about the programs, hit some highlights, and then we'll open it up. So Housing Authority basically has three primary programs. Section 8 is our number one. Those are our housing needs vouchers. We've got about 1,650 vouchers. Generates about $13 million of housing assistance payments. These are funds that we receive from HUD to pay for these vouchers. Out of that, we also receive about $1 million to administer the program, which is probably about 75 to 80% of what the actual costs are. We also then have public housing. We have about 550 units of public housing. Most of those are in four parks in Oregon City and Milwaukee, but we also have 150 scattered sites. These are usually single family, kind of spread throughout the county. The public housing, even though they're very, very low income, a lot of them do pay rent. So we generate about $1.4 million a year in rent from public housing that goes back to the operations. And then HUD provides us about $3.9 million worth of funds for the operation and maintenance of the program. Our smallest program is the capital program. This is $881,000. These are funds that HUD gives the housing authority to maintain public housing. So, we figure that we've got about $14 million worth of needs, and we've got about $881,000 worth of money to fix those. So that kind of leads me to one of the major successes, I think, at the Housing Authority. First of all, Housing Authority of Clackamas County is the first housing authority in the state, and it started about 1937. We've got housing that was built in 1938 that we're still maintaining, and we're able to maintain that at what they call a high performer status. So that means we meet all of the housing goals, all of the occupancy goals, all of the finance goals. It is a testament to the work that our maintenance staff does to maintain that. So that's something I'm very proud of, and we're continuing to maintain that. The only program that's really growing is the VASH vouchers. These are vouchers that we receive to house our veterans. We started with 25, we're now up to 51. I'm really proud to say that we're probably the only jurisdiction in the area that has 100% lease up of our VASH vouchers. On top of the 51 of our own that we lease up, we also have 10 VASH vouchers that have moved into Clackamas County that we also take care of. So, Housing Authority is moving along real well. I think probably the most successful project that we've done in the last year was the completion of the Town Center Greens project. That's a 60-unit alcohol and drug-free housing project over near Clackamas Town Center. So that project was opened, it is full, and there's a waiting list. So that's the good news. What are the challenges? Well, I mean, the number one challenge is lack of affordable housing in Clackamas County. Actually, lack of affordable housing anywhere. But, we're interested in Clackamas County. Things have shifted a little bit, but the vacancy rate in our affordable housing units is now up to 1.5%. It was only at 1%. So things have gotten a little bit better, but it's still very difficult to find an affordable housing unit. For Section 8, this is one of those good news, bad news. Good news is that Section 8 is spending, 100% of all of the money that HUD gives us for vouchers. Unfortunately, we're having to pay so much for each voucher that we're only able to assist about 94% of the vouchers that we do hold. What that means is that we're spending more per voucher than HUD gives us per voucher. So there's about 100 families that we could help if we had rents that were a little bit more affordable and didn't have to spend as much money with the vouchers. we also have something called turnback. So this is vouchers that have been out, that are out. And we have families that have waited 7 years, they've got their voucher, they're out looking for housing, and after about 90 days, they can't find it, they have to return those vouchers. Historically, that number was about 11%. Last year, it topped out at 30%. So 30% of the vouchers out there were being returned. We're now seeing, that's come down a little bit, but it's still about 20%. But the reason, of course, is that we have to pay more now for these families to get into these units. So that's in a nutshell what's been going on at the Housing Authority. The 5-year plan, you're going to see it's got a number of components. It's got the 5-year strategic plan, an annual implementation plan. It also has amendments to the administrative plan for the Section 8 program and what we call the ACOP, which is the administrative plan for public housing. Anytime we make a change, we have to include that in the plan, and it has to go through a process. So with that, I'd be happy to answer any questions and then open it up for public testimony.
Any questions? Yes, Ken.
Okay. Yes, Mr. Chairman. I had one question and one comment. One question that I was just curious about, under your bedroom definitions, it says that you have to have a closet, and I was curious because in some jurisdiction, an armoire is considered sufficient for a closet. Is that the case for your facilities?
Yeah, that's a great question, and I don't know. I can't answer that. I know that at my house, I have an armoire in a room downstairs, and I was told that it doesn't qualify as a bedroom because it's not a built-in closet. Okay. But that's Gresham, so I don't know what it is out here. We could probably ask some of the experts out in the stands.
I was just curious.
I can look into that, though, and I'll get back to you.
I appreciate it. Mm-hmm. The other thing I noticed was that your uncollected rents were about $7,500 out of a budget that was over $13 million plus the VASH vouchers. Mm-hmm. That's less than 1/10 or 1/100 of 1%, and I think that's a testament to effective management. So I just wanted to comment on that.
Appreciate that.
Any other questions? Okay, we're going to open the public portion of this hearing on the proposed 2017-2022 Housing Authority. Does anyone wish to testify? I've got no blue cards. Okay, we'll close the public hearing and announce that there is no board action this evening on this item. We'll bring it back for board approval on April 6, 2017 at a regular scheduled business meeting at 10 a.m. Next is the Housing Authority Consent Agenda.
Okay, there's two items on the Housing Authority Consent Agenda in the matter of writing off uncollectible accounts for the third quarter of fiscal year 2017 and a reappointment of the resident commissioner to the Housing Authority Board.
Great. Commissioner?
Okay, I move we approve the Housing Authority Consent Agenda.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded to approve the Housing Authority Consent Agenda. Any further discussion? All those in favor say aye. Paul, you can't vote. Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Motion carries. Thanks.
Ball.
Not that. That ball.
I forgot.
You're just reappointed. Good job.
Well, thank you.
Well, thanks.
Thank
What's the pay?
Yeah.
Huh? What's the pay?
What's
the pay?
Jim was going to offer to double that, and I'll triple that.
Yeah.
Gee, thanks.
All right. Well, thank you, Paul.
Thank you.
Thanks for being here today.
Next item is citizen communications, and we have Gail Herman and Les Poole.
We got it.
Did you do the reconvene?
Oh, maybe I didn't reconvene.
Oh,
thank
yeah.
you, Paul. So you can go ahead and sit. It's not going to affect what you say. So I'm going to reconvene as the Board of County Commissioners. Who's ever wants to start?
Okay. Mr. Chairman, honored members of the council, my husband Tim and I have been residents of Clackamas County for 25 years. And during that time, we have worked here and raised a family. Our daughter graduated from Oregon City High, and she and her husband live in Happy Valley. Tim and I are current owners of the Viewpoint on Springwater. We are part of this community and consider Clackamas County our home. The Viewpoint is located at 20189 South Springwater Road in Estacada. It's currently zoned rural residential farm forest. It's approximately 4.5 acres. The parcel numbers are 2000 and 2100, which you see on the attached location map on page 2. In 2012, the past owner had applied for an alteration of the existing use to add an outdoor serving area south of the existing building. The criteria was satisfied and the request was approved. The area was used for 2 summers before the sale of the building and property in 2015 to me and my husband. The reason for my visit this evening is there are conditions listed with that decision that we would like to be readdressed. Specifically, the issue on page 8, 5E, which addresses that there will be not any amplified sound systems. We have been in contact with the Planning and Zoning Division at Clackamas County, but have not been able to get consistent responses to the definition of amplified music or to our request of revising this condition. We were not aware of these conditions until late last summer and have tried since October to be able to move forward in getting this issue readdressed. The past owner hosted events such as the American Legion Car Show, which benefits the veterans at Carl Douglas Post 74, Estacada High School class reunions, and local community functions. The area is right next to Springwater Road and with the road noise, the owner had placed speakers in the area for music to help alleviate the sounds of the traffic. The events held had public address systems and live music to create a pleasant atmosphere. My husband and I have continued in the spirit of the community, hosting the American Legion Car Show, Estacada High School class reunions, and we also have added events that benefit melanoma cancer research, the food bank, and this year we were planning on adding fallen heroes and matching donations given through the open season. We have approval from the OLCC to have music in the garden. In addition, the Clackamas County Sheriff has measured the decibels in our parking lot, and the closest residence from their point of measurement is approximately 200 feet. The officers had a reading of under 60 decibels and stated that it was hard to measure because of the traffic noise from Springwater Road. In keeping with the noise ordinance, we make sure that the music is over by 9 p.m. Our goal is to have a family-friendly, pet-friendly area that is committed to make an enjoyable experience for our customers and be part of our community and making our community a better place. Thank you for your attention and time.
So, you need to introduce yourself first, so why don't you go ahead and do that.
I'm Gail Herman.
Okay, so I'm sure we'll take a look at this. I don't know if you've applied or the process, but we'll take a look at this.
Okay.
So are you the applicant?
I am the owner of, I'm the owner of the viewpoint.
So you're not
no.
This is all.
Okay.
Yeah, it just states that this was the amendment to the, you know, alteration to the current zoning.
Okay, I think I know where this place is. Yeah. All right, great. Les, thank you.
It's an awesome place. Yeah, the weather's incredible. I almost put on the Hawaiian shirt. And it was fun dodging potholes on the way here in the sunshine. The budget's being hammered out, if I can use the term right now. And obviously, you've got requests from all corners, and no doubt the requests probably exceed how much money's going to be available. So my question is, how do the citizens know where we're at this point? I mean, ultimately, there'll be a budget hearing. I understand that. And then once the budget's decided in June, we'll have a public hearing. But between now and then, what outreach can the county do to inform the citizens of where money's going, where it's tentatively slotted? Interestingly, yesterday on Facebook, an event flew by, and it was a Washington County open house on their budget that they held in Beaverton, I believe. Not that you have to go to that extent, but things in the newspaper, things on the website, opportunities when you speak at the end of the meetings to fill us in on what your thoughts are would be great. The other thing I want to mention real briefly is I can recall a few years ago when a gentleman came in here and he had a code enforcement issue, speaking of code enforcement, and in frustration because he was being charged with a violation when the code didn't exist. One day he came in here and there was words said and he finally got frustrated and he tried to stage a silent protest for the last 2.5 minutes of his time. Got hauled out of here. Now why am I bringing that up? Well, because in 2013 I spent considerable time with Dan Chandler and the staff, and they were great to work with, trying to craft the ordinance for dealing with disruptive people. And that ordinance, what was initially presented, was honed down and refined, and no doubt it's in effect today. I am seeing ridiculous disruptive behavior in the city of Portland at their council meetings that no citizen and no one in this room should be expected to tolerate. I saw in the newspaper that they're crafting their disruptive persons policy. There are hundreds of thousands of people living in Portland. And for a handful of people to come in and shut down the ability for government to function is crazy, and they're not winning any sympathy. So hopefully we don't have any of that here in the future. This is a place where people should be heard. That Oregon Constitution talks about free speech, and it says we're also responsible to not violate others' free speech. And it's just, for lack of a better description, totally uncool. I see Ken Humberson smiling, and I appreciate that. As a former officer, I think you know the definition between being disruptive, being out of control, and being within your rights. Thank you all.
Thanks. And actually, on the wall back there is, we never did actually craft an ordinance. We on the wall back there is just a
guidelines
for citizens, and that was Jamie Damon worked really hard on that, but we have had very little of that, and I hope that never occurs. Don's going to introduce.
I was just going to make mention in response to Mr. Poole's questions about the outreach process for the budget. Of course, we will. When the budget is drafted, be reaching out in Citizen News on the county website and at a series of public meetings associated with budget deliberations. Our budget committee will be meeting next in the afternoon of April the 12th, and they'll get an update at that time as to where we're at with regard to the current projections for the general fund and current year-to-date expenditures, and a preliminary snapshot of the budget process that will unfold in earnest beginning in May. On the 23rd of May, there will be another budget committee meeting that will be an opportunity to develop questions for staff to be able to pursue and follow up on for a discussion with the full budget committee for their deliberations during the last week and first week for last week in May and the first week in June. We'll have the full week and a half devoted to budget deliberations and public hearings at that time. Also, prior to the actual delivery of the budget to the budget committee, I expect that I will be presenting here the annual budget 101 presentation that I typically and routinely do to kind of go through the process and the schedule that we will go through. Should also let folks know that, you know, we're in the process now of developing the budget. I will have my first opportunity to hear from all of the departments and offices in 2 weeks, over a two-week period in the month of April, to go through virtually every department and office budget proposal at that time, and from there develop what would be the county administrator's recommendation for consideration at that time.
Also, I wanted to mention that we're going kind of through a new budget process using management for results, and at some point there will be some sort of gauge kind of thing, right?
That's correct.
Yeah. That's right, that people can look and see how successful the efforts are that we're doing in various departments. So we still have portions of the agency that are still working on that process, but we're trying to make the budget more understandable and hopefully thinner. All right, so with that, we'll move on to our discussion item. Don?
Yes, Mr. Chair, this discussion item is from the Department of Transportation and Development, and its consideration of approval of the Clackamas County Long-Range Planning Work Program for 2017-2018. We have our planning director, Mr. Mike McCallister, here to present this to you. And this is a public discussion item, so citizens have an opportunity to comment on the proposed work plan. Mr. McCallister?
Thank you. Good evening, commissioners. For the record, Mike McCallister, I'm the planning director. And thanks for this opportunity to be here. We're here to discuss the long-range planning work program for the Planning and Zoning Division and Transportation Planning Department. Just a little bit of background. The work program is focused really on projects that include changes or amendments to the County Comprehensive Plan, to the Zoning Development Ordinance, or the County Transportation System Plan. It doesn't include other day-to-day work that we do in those divisions and public services and processing applications. So it's really focused on projects associated with those three public documents. As part of developing the work program, this is about the third year or fourth year we've done this, We have done some outreach to CPOs and hamlets and villages, soliciting ideas and projects for the work program. We also have another interested parties list of folks that we send that request to. And then we also notify a lot of divisions internally within DTD in the county, the Parks Department and Business and Community Services, our engineering staff, et cetera, to see if they have ideas that they want to consider for the work program. Once that was done, that public outreach was done, staff, the planning staff and the transportation planning staff kind of did a review and analyzed those projects. And we made a recommendation to the Planning Commission for that work program. The Planning Commission held a public meeting back in February 6th. It was similar to this. It wasn't a formal public hearing, but it was a public meeting. There was folks were invited to testify in regards to their projects and ideas, and those were considered by the Planning Commission. The Planning Commission forwarded a recommendation to the board. I'll talk about that a little bit later on in the discussion. And then you're charged tonight, of course, with making a final decision on the work program for 2017-2018. You have broad discretion generally in adopting the work program. Things that the staff considered in evaluating the proposals, because we got a lot of them, is we prioritized those. We looked at sort of the timing of the amendments, whether, you know, it's important to do it now, it's important to can it be held off at a later date. We looked at the concept of some of these projects and they could they be done in context with another project that might be coming down the pipe. Just ways to kind of create efficiencies in the work that we do along the way. Of course, there are sometimes grants that might be applicable, the timing of those grants. There's some things in some instances, and there is one project this year that we were required to do by law. We considered other board priorities that are known board priorities in developing this work program. And along the way, the main goal here is to align this work program with our staffing resources and the budget to make this work. We've looked at our staffing resources for this project, both for the planning-related projects and also the transportation projects. And basically, we have about 1.65 to just over 2 FTE for the planning division-related projects and about 1.5 FTE for the transportation projects. And even though they're all in the same context, the same work program, because of the different funding sources for the planning and transportation projects, there really isn't much ability to kind of match or mix that FTE up because of those funding sources. You have a packet of information, including a summary to the board, a staff report that was provided by myself, that was given to the Planning Commission as part of the February Planning Commission meeting. And as part of that staff report, you have all the exhibits that were information that were submitted from the CPOs and hamlets and villages and other interested parties. And then you have three tables in that packet. And I just wanna summarize those tables. The first one is what is known as attachment 2, and it's table 1A. And you don't know if you have colored copies or not. I actually have oversized large copies if this is easier for you to look at that we can provide to you. Karen has them if you want something besides what's on your laptop there.
Yeah, I'll take one of those.
Okay. And attachment 2, table 1A, is the list of projects recommended by the Planning Commission. There are 4 planning division related projects on this list. There are 3 additional planning projects that the Planning Commission recommended. However, they recommended those knowing that there were not adequate resources, but if there were other resources found, they prioritized those additional 3 additional projects. And then there are 6 transportation projects on that list recommended by the Planning Commission. So that's attachment 2.
Hey, Mike? Yes. I'm going to save you some work, so I don't want you to repeat this twice. So what I intend to do is actually, I want to be able to check off what we're going to approve or what your recommendation is, okay?
Yes.
because there's been some people that have read the packet that are, I think, at least one of them's in the audience that I've communicated with, and I think there's some confusion around what Table 1A is and what Table 1B is and what is recommended and perhaps what we're going to approve. So I'm looking at page 1 of Table 1A, Attachment 2.
Thank you.
So your recommendation is number 1, all the way to the left, number 1, right?
Yeah.
Okay, and number 2.
Uh-huh. So, Commissioner Savas, you would I'll probably be there in just a minute, if that's okay?
Okay.
Yeah. I just kind of want to identify what's out there, and then I'll come talk about those in a little more detail, and then I'll actually be very clear about the recommendation and the project number. Is that okay?
Make sure you're not repeating yourself.
Yes.
Unnecessarily.
No, thank you. So attachment 3, table 1B, is some other planning projects that are in options for work around McLaughlin Boulevard area, Park Avenue Station area plan, McLaughlin Boulevard, et cetera. And these were developed in response to some feedback that we got from the Board of County Commissioners, particularly at a study session a week or so ago, and other comments we've got from the board. And then attachment 4, which is table 2, is other projects and options that we got ideas for McLaughlin Boulevard that were not recommended as part of the work program. But I want to let people know that if there was some other, you know, we got about 20 or 30 projects in total, and so these ones that were considered, but they were not included on the work program recommendation by the Planning Commission or the staff. Getting to Commissioner Savas' point, I want to go back and focus on Table 2.
1A.
Excuse me, Attachment 2, Table 1A. Okay? And I want to talk about each of those projects. So, and this is the recommendation by the staff and the Planning Commission. So project number 1 on this table is continued work on the zoning and development, audit of the zoning and development ordinance. And as you know, we've been working on a number of years. The idea is to continue work on that project, involving 1.1 to 1.5 FTE. The reason there is a range there is that there is a likelihood of a person who's working part-time who's been principally engaged in an audit that may retire. And we may or may not be able to fill that in some sort of timely fashion. This project is important, of course, from staff's perspective because it has countywide benefit. It really affects, it's really important from my perspective that we keep momentum on this. You know, we've stopped working on the audit over the years in a number of cases for some very valid reasons, marijuana and other things, but it's difficult and becomes a little bit inefficient. Once we do that, get start up again, we lose momentum. So I think it's very important to continue that work. It also benefits all our county, all our customers. We've seen great improvements in audit and the use of tables. We're getting good comments. It affects our development review. It affects all the customers that come into the lobby. It affects people looking at our ordinance online. And so I think it's really important to include that. Project number 2 on this attachment is updating the floodplain regulations. There is a lawsuit that was against the state of Oregon. It has to do with how the Federal Emergency Management Agency administers floodplain regulations. The lawsuit alleged that the implementation of those floodplain regulations violate or potentially violate Endangered Species Act, including many fisheries in the state of Oregon. As a result of that, there is a biological opinion that came out from the National Marine Fisheries Service, and it's directing FEMA to make changes in Oregon, Oregon local jurisdictions, take changes to the floodplain ordinance. Pretty big deal. We are required by law to do it. We could probably not do it, but we may be in violation of the Endangered Species Act, have other implications with that.
Are we going to throw that out anyway?
Who knows? It's also an important project, again, because it's required by law, but also that it does have impact countywide on how we administer floodplain regulations. The timing of this is a little bit critical because we are required to adopt those regulations by March of 2018. FEMA has told the county that they will begin in a sort of model ordinances and direction on how to do those changes. They won't be till the fall sometime, whatever that is. I'm a little bit concerned it'll be late fall. It will give us a very short turnaround time to amend those ordinances and get them to the Planning Commission and the Board for adoption. The third project on Attachment 2A is project number 3, and that is a general category for transitional housing. The Board knows this has been something that has been a Board priority to address homelessness and transitional housing opportunities in the county. Been working on that for a couple years. In effect, staff put a placeholder for this project into next year's work program to do some ordinance amendments or outreach or whatever that might be. If you recall, Tuesday, earlier this week, there was a study session with the Board. The Board gave staff direction to initiate a zoning ordinance amendment to allow transitional shelter projects in industrial zones in the county. So in effect, this is a placeholder to complete that project. And we certainly can have conversations about, because this work program begins in July of this year, staff is certainly open towards initiating that project earlier, recognizing that it would displace some other work in the audit in this year's program, but we would just flip that work, do this work this year and flip some of the other work that we're supposed to do this year into this whole placeholder for next year. So we're open to that. We can certainly accommodate that adjustment in the work program. Fourth project is around development and design standards for the Park Avenue Station area. And this is in part a proposal that we got from MAPIT, the McLaughlin Area Plan Implementation Team. So what staff has recommended under this project is 3 specific items for the work program. One would be to consider, MAPIT has proposed some amendments already to the zoning and development ordinance relative to some design standards and things like that that would happen in the commercial zoning district around Park Avenue. For example, some building design standards, how buildings look and potentially setbacks and some things like that. Right now in the zoning, right now in the audit that we are doing, we're actually looking at sections of the zoning ordinance to deal with building design standards and some other standards in the C3 zoning district. We would just in effect fold those design standards that they are considering into the audit and consider them in the context of the zoning ordinance provisions that we are looking at that will be coming before you and the Planning Commission in the near future. The second one is to do outreach to the property owners around the Park Avenue Station area about whether there's interest, consensus, ideas about design standards around Park Avenue. And it would be, and this is a project that the Board has heard about in a number of years, and from staff's perspective, we think it's really important that we engage those commercial property owners directly, and is their interest in requiring mixed use or limiting developments or changing parking standards or whatever that is. And so the nature of this is to have outreach, direct outreach to those property owners and to other folks in the area about, is there some concepts and ideas and design standards that you can build consensus on around those? It would not involve actually doing plan amendments and the zoning ordinance, but seeing if you can build consensus around those ideas. Commissioner Savas.
Was that commercial only or commercial and residential?
So this would be to look at just the commercial zoning district, but I would envision involving engagement with commercial property owners and other property owners that might have interest in that.
Because it's only a half mile, so that doesn't include a lot of commercial.
Yeah, there, and as when I say Park Avenue Stationary Plan, I'm generally envisioning something around a half mile around the station. And you know, as we move this forward, you can modify those boundaries if there's some roads or something that makes sense. But I think that's the starting point, a half mile around the station area.
But if it's commercial, practically speaking, it's north and south almost.
Exactly. Okay. That's exactly correct. And then the last part of this, the third bullet under this, would support is to, there's been discussions in the community about a grant to do more extensive work around the Park Avenue station area. And generally, MAPIT cannot apply for a grant. It's going to have to come from the county. So our commitment in this project is that the county staff would work to support and file a grant, and the nature of that would be to scope that grant with the MAPIT folks to see what that looks like, and the county would apply for that grant. Our role in that grant would be really that, and the grant would be, because there's limited resources to this project, 0.20 FTE, the idea is if there was a grant achieved for that project, that it would be consultant-driven. The consultant would do it. We'd figure out who's involved and who's at the table. Our role there would be really just to help with the grant, and in some cases would be available for some technical support as they're moving forward. And again, the scope of this grant is not ending up with comp plan amendments and zoning ordinance amendment. Is can you build concepts and consensus around ideas that would happen to do some better design standards around the Park Avenue station area plan?
Commercial or residential?
Yes, and just commercial, and hold that thought. But just commercial. So those are the projects that were recommended by the staff and the Planning Commission. There's three other projects on here that are planning-related projects. They are labeled as projects 15, 16, and 27. 15 is looking at amending our rural tourist building design, maximum building design standards or square footage standards. 16 is basically a comprehensive plan amendment for the entire McLaughlin area, MAPIT area, which is an entire McLaughlin area, McLaughlin Corridor Boulevard between Milwaukee and Gladstone, and all the MAPIT area, all the residential areas. That is a huge, significant project. It would probably require multiple FTE over multiple years, and we are not amending that. However, the previous project 4 that I just talked has some components of that.
So you're not, you say, not amending or not recommending?
Not recommending that. And then number 27 is look at some dog kennel standards, and we're not recommending that also. So those are the planning department projects. There's 7 of them there. We're recommending the first 4, not the last 3. Then projects 5 through 9 are all transportation projects that would be done by the Transportation Planning Division. We have heard really no testimony or no issues associated with those projects. I don't intend to talk about them in any more detail. Karen Bierig, our transportation planning supervisor, in the audience, if you want to ask some questions about her, about those projects when I conclude the presentation. So, a couple things, and I'll wrap up and I'll get to my recommendation. I want to move towards attachment 3. Table 1B.
One second. I just want to go back to number on the one you just covered, number 10 on the back page. That is transportation. Because it actually speaks to sewer, to infrastructure and things beyond transportation. So you mentioned the ones were all transportation. Yeah, is that one?
It's probably both. It's probably all of those. But it would, because of the nature of the grant, the work would probably be managed under the Transportation Planning Division.
Okay.
Yeah, they would be managing that work, but it's all.
Ken had a question, too.
I want to clarify something around the Park Avenue station. You said a half a mile radius, but the focus is on the commercial strip part of that, and you want to reach out to the commercial property owners. The reason you're including a half a mile circular area around it is so that the people who live close to that commercial area have some voice in how this goes through, but it's not intended to expand the commercial area into the residential area.
That's
Am I correct?
All right, that's correct.
I wanted to make sure that was clear for everyone.
Right.
The second thing is I noted in reading the materials that on item 15, building size in a rural tourist commercial area, I was pleased to see that you picked up something from 2015 that looked like it would have fallen through the cracks otherwise. so that it can get resolved one way or the other. So thank you.
Okay. So in attachment three, table 1B, in response to the study session a couple weeks ago about the work program, things we've heard from commissioners, et cetera, we put this list of options together of things that could happen in the McLaughlin Boulevard area generally. And there's really four of those on here. The first one is a really focused around the Park Avenue stationary plan, and it, again, the half-mile radius, and it would look towards doing a really very comprehensive plan around that area, including amendments to the comprehensive planning and zoning development ordinance. The second one is looking at really at the corridor, and that, when I say the corridor, actually McLaughlin Boulevard and the commercial corridor strip only between basically Milwaukee and Gladstone, and looking at how you might improve that corridor for employment and housing. And again, I'll talk about my response to some of these things.
Just going back to number one. So number one was commercial and residential. Just want to make sure we have that clarification fully through. So number one, the on attachment three.
Right. So it would include, in a sense, the map, the neighborhoods around McLaughlin Boulevard. Yep. Number three is about this idea of neighborhood protection or preservation in the neighborhoods in that mapped area around the commercial corridor. And we've identified over on the very kind of right-hand column of this a number of options that we could be considered for neighborhood preservation or protection and that sort of thing. And again, I'll talk about our recommendations regarding that list in just a minute. And the last one, number four, is a McLaughlin area plan, looking at the broad area, all the way the map it was covered, the commercial corridor, the multifamily, all the residential areas, the entire map of corridor, and doing a long-range plan associated with that. We anticipate that would be an extensive amount of FTE in multiple-year process. So those are options that we set forth for basically the mapped area, Park Avenue, McLaughlin Corridor, commercial strip, et cetera. Staff's recommendation, and this is consistent with the Planning Commission recommendation, on table
1A.
On attachment 2, table 1A. The staff is recommending the first four planning projects, one, the zoning ordinance audit, two, the floodplain regulations, three, the transitional housing, four, the development and design standards for the Park Avenue station area, and on number four, again, the project summary, there's three bullet points there, looking at stuff that we can do in the audit, helping with a grant, and doing outreach to the commercial property owners. Those are the three things that are in that recommendation now. Staff is recommending two additional bullets to that recommendation. One would be to develop some voluntary mechanisms for looking at the residential areas around that about neighborhood preservation and neighborhood character and those sort of things. And in effect, if you look at table attachment 3, table 1B, that is under number 3. There's a neighborhood protection things in there. We have some information in there under number 1 about some voluntary mechanisms and how do you create a package of tools or things that the community use to put voluntary restrictions on their property. And we think we can provide some information like that. That's one. The second one is to expand. Remember, one of the bullets is to help map it, develop a grant to look at the commercial core around the Park Avenue station area, and to expand the nature, the scope of that grant to including the neighborhood residential areas within a half mile around the Park Avenue station and to sort of assess those neighborhoods. How do you do, if you do things in the commercial core or the multifamily, how do you protect and preserve those residential, low-density residential areas named? So we would look at adding that to the scope of the grant. And again, if that grant's approved, we would foresee that being consultant-driven, but we would assist map it. We work directly with the map it folks to scope that grant and to work with them in submitting the grant.
That's an assessment.
Yes, an assessment, opportunities, concepts, whatever you would do. And the same thing would be in the commercial core or the multifamily. And we aren't looking at doing plan amendments or doing, but what concepts, what opportunities do you have, what things can the community agree on in those to make that urbanized, to make it work, make it compatible, to charge that commercial core, to protect the residential areas, et cetera. So you build that into the grant proposal.
So the assessment would include things like those who might be living in low-income or low-cost housing today that may be perhaps in jeopardy, things like...
I think the assessment could include a lot of things, those sort of things, density, current densities. It could include things like physical development, where there are sidewalks, not sidewalks. I mean, there's a lot of things that you could look at to assess that. And we would talk about that and scope that in the grant. So those are the additional recommendations to project number 4. And then we would recommend all the 6 planning, transportation planning projects, 5 through 10. And that would be the staff's recommendation.
Okay.
I want to just talk a little bit, kind of expand on the grant concept a little bit. Again, the county's role would be to assist mapping and scoping it and to apply for the grant. We would see it being consultant-driven, consultant-run. A lot of community folks that have said they're ready to engage in that. It would include a geographic area about a half mile around the Park Avenue station area. Certainly there would be some ability to maybe if there's some logical boundaries or roads that we could certainly work around those boundaries a little bit, but the half mile would be the starting place. Again, it would be sort of how do you assess opportunities and concepts and those sort of things. It would not include amendments to the comp plan and zoning ordinance, but the outcome of that grant, what that looks like, if those are, if you develop concepts and ideas and things like that, as you move forward in the next work program, you talk about those things that could be added into the comp plan, the ZDO, or the transportation system plan. And then those sort of concepts that you get consensus on and ideas that are in that half mile, then over time you have a conversation about, can you move those down the corridor? Moving towards Gladstone and other nodes or other blocks or all the way down, can you use those things to build future work going down the corridor? So that's what I have. Happy to answer any questions. Again, Karen's here if you have any questions on the transportation project.
So on the latter thing, that, you know, this work would serve as a template for going down the boulevard, basically.
Exactly. Yes.
So my question is on your recommendation on this area around the Park Avenue, the public outreach piece, or would this consultant be the one who would engage the residents?
Yes.
So it wouldn't be a burden on staff.
Correct.
So to speak.
Yep.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. And on the grant, I think it's important to know, and there's some timing components. We're gonna have to move pretty quickly because there's some timing, some grant, but this ultimately the grant and the scope of the grant is gonna come back before the board. But the staff would work directly with MAPIT and their board and their committee and say, what do we do? And ultimately the board would because of the grant nature, the board would see that. We develop that with you, you know, and get feedback and that kind of thing.
Okay, so, however, if you go to table 2 and you look at 23, which is urban rural reserves, it actually talks about the Beaver Creek Hamlet,
yeah.
And it says completed by the end of June 2017.
Mm-hmm.
Does that mean you're working on this and it will, or you're not going to do that?
Table 2 is the not recommended.
So this was a suggested project.
Okay.
It's not.
Oh, okay.
It was a suggested project.
So you said it'd be 2017 if you did it.
Yes. It's not a recommended project.
Well, I know. It says not recommended, but in the staff comments, it could be done by 2017.
Correct. That's the current urban rural project path we're going down right now.
So and it will be done in June 2017, in theory. Still confused.
It was not recommended, so no.
Hopefully.
Now I'm confused. My understanding was all of Table 2, which is what Commissioner Bernard is reading from, is not recommended, so will not happen.
No, it is not recommended, right.
So it's not recommended.
Correct.
So it won't be nothing will be completed on here because it's not recommended to be completed.
The board's already doing that project.
Yeah, so right. I mean, so it's kind of on an odd page because it's not recommended to get done by June.
No, I understand. Yeah, the board's already doing that project. Okay. Yes.
That's what I thought.
Yeah.
And that's why I asked. So in the past 4 years, Mr. Madkour, you've actually gone through some of these, like mass gatherings, that is on the not recommended list. Is it possible to bring some of those proposals that we set aside in the past for review?
Yes.
Again, so mass gathering is one of them.
We're ready to roll with mass gatherings if the board has the appetite for revisiting it. We have all that ordinance drafted and the land use language all prepared. We're ready to proceed with that if directed to
and
do so.
And so there may be others like that wouldn't require staff time. I mean, I don't see them specifically on the list, but there are some others like that. Because you also have a committee that kind of reviews the work they do before it comes to us for consideration under some circumstances.
Correct, the code update committee.
Yeah.
And just for clarification, the previous work that we did on the mass gathering, requiring permits and those sort of things for smaller numbers, that was a project that would be embedded in the county code. It's not in the zoning development ordinance. And so it wouldn't be in the scope of one of our projects. Okay. We may participate or, but it's a county code project, not a zoning ordinance.
Great. Yeah. Thank you. So, I mean, I'm interested in looking at some of those issues. I think I had one more question. I guess that's it for now. So we got you ready? We ready to move on? We have a few people who want to talk. Okay, well, we'll open the public comment section, and we'll start with Joseph Edge and Nate Ember. And please give your name and where you live. We're going to give you 3 minutes.
All right. Thank you. I'm Nate Ember. I live in Oak Grove, right near the edge of Milwaukee. Thank you guys for all of your support in moving these projects forward. The community has been asking for these for a long time, as you know. Map process started a long time ago, so the community has been eager to see these things happen. This really is a key opportunity. Working on the zoning, especially, is the key tool that the community has to implement a lot of what's in MAP, because we don't have urban renewal, we don't have other sources of funds. So letting the market drive the transformation the community is looking for is what we're hoping to maximize. So I think the staff's recommendation speaks towards a lot of that, but I think it also is not quite as holistic and ambitious as what I think might be possible and what we've kind of started to advocate for, or many of us have started to advocate for, where we realize the limited capacity that staff has to move some of this stuff forward and respect that limit. But we can start to imagine lots of ways that grant funding and consultants and the community taking on kind of a different kind of approach than what's been used in the past, where we really can be a productive member of doing a lot of this work. We think that a lot of these things can actually be captured in a shorter time period than what a normal process might look like. And we really hope that that can happen. So I would say we support the allocations of staff time, but would want to focus that in support of a potentially larger effort to accomplish a lot more through kind of a different process. But if everyone's open to that, that's kind of where I think the community is.
Yeah, I guess I'd just like to comment on that comment. Mm-hmm. So I've met with you guys and seen some of your ideas and concepts. I've also asked the EDC, our Economic Development Commission, to take a look at some of your concepts and your presenting. And so I kind of see this as maybe an opportunity to do something a little different, take a different path. And because, you know, one of the problems with McLaughlin Boulevard is that maybe people don't know that Clackamas County is interested in something new on McLaughlin Boulevard, different investment opportunities. And I think that's a way to kind of communicate. I was telling you earlier that I've gotten three or four phone calls about developers who no longer want to develop in Portland, and so they're looking south to Clackamas County. And of course, all of them want to do it in downtown Milwaukee, but it's not big enough for all that. So there is an opportunity to direct them up the road a bit, take advantage of the mass transit opportunities. And so, I mean, that is kind of my goal. I've asked the EDC to get involved in that process and start communicating, finding out from the business community what interests they might have. And with you, the work you guys are doing, and with some of these zoning and development ordinance changes that'll take place in the audit, there is a lot of opportunity to find out. But I've also, I mean, you mentioned it earlier, not a single person has come to ask about it. So that says to me, something's wrong. We're not communicating and say, look to Clackamas County. Because no one's come and said, well, you need to tweak this or tweak that, and we'll be there. So we got to communicate better to the rest of the community. So hopefully, Les, look to your audience and ask them to look to Clackamas County. Thank you. Oh, yes.
I do have a question for Nate. Was your last name Burton before?
Yes.
Okay. Because I think that's come up a lot. I knew you as Burton before, so all right. Thank you.
Joseph.
good evening, commissioners. My name is Joseph Edge. I grew up in the Oak Grove area, and I reside there now and have for the past few years. I'm here tonight as a member of the McLaughlin Area Plan Implementation Team, where I'm also the chair of its Land Use and Transportation Committee. I represent the Oak Grove Community Council on MAPIT. I'm also on the board of directors of the Oak Grove Community Council. We're quickly approaching 10 years ago when MAP was initially funded by the county, and we really think it's important to move this work forward, and we're really appreciative of staff's recommendation for Park Avenue Design Standards Project. It's a major part of realizing MAP is starting to build these nodes of activity centers along the corridor and focus new development in targeted areas where it makes sense and can be accommodated by the infrastructure without any public investment. And so we really see a big opportunity here to add family wage employment, add jobs, add housing that is much needed. You know, we're in the middle of a severe housing crisis in this region. And one of the major things that's missing is supply. And, you know, we feel like McLaughlin Boulevard can offer to fill some of that supply. It'll also take pressure off of the surrounding neighborhoods. If people have an option outside of the neighborhoods, but in our area where there's clearly a lot of demand to be, then, you know, we feel like the commercial corridor could satisfy a lot of that need, while including, you know, jobs as well. And so we're looking forward to our meeting with the EDC, to our presentation with the EDC, and finding out what they can recommend to us as far as, recruiting businesses and industries that are compatible in mixed-use developments with housing uses as well as their office uses. We see that as a big opportunity, especially at the station area, but there's a lot of technical fixes that are necessary to the zoning ordinance, and everything to be able to accommodate this kind of development. McLaughlin allows what's called high-density residential housing right now, 25 units an acre, but in the actual high-density residential zones adjacent to McLaughlin, you can actually rezone those to 60 units an acre. I don't know why that wouldn't be allowed on the commercial corridor. The prerequisite for that is that you're immediately adjacent to the commercial corridor with high-quality transit, and you can get this rezoning. I don't know why we wouldn't change that outright in the commercial zone, just as an example. And so that's kind of a thing that could be solved with the audit for the whole corridor-long revitalization that we're looking at, and the EDC can help us with that as well. And so, we're looking forward to that. We think the neighborhood preservation is a major component of this as well. These are complementary, and I really think that we would appreciate a commitment to work on all aspects, you know, including the neighborhood preservation component of this work, because it is going to create pressure on these neighborhoods that will lead to gentrification and displacement if we're not careful. And we're inviting, you know, more activity, putting more amenities on McLaughlin Boulevard. There's 32,000, there's more than 32,000 jobs that pay better than $40,000 a year within a 30-minute transit trip and walk from Park Avenue Station. And that's creating a lot of pressure on the neighborhoods right around there of people who that's convenient for them, and they have the means and are willing to pay more than our current residents are. And so this is leading to displacement today. And it's really important that we move forward on this project and figure out how to solve these problems on a very short time frame. So I would really appreciate your assistance and staff's assistance with getting grants so that we can turn this around on a rather quick time frame so that we can start solving these problems that are impacting real people today. Thank you very much.
Great, thank you. Next, we have Terry Gibson and Stephanie Kurzenhauser. See how well I did on that.
No T's in it.
That's why I don't use his last name. I keep throwing the T in there. Thanks. Thanks for coming.
Thank you.
Tonight.
My name is Terry Gibson. I'm the vice chair of MAPIT, and I'm on the board of the Jennings Lodge Community Planning Organization. And I'm going to cede my time to Stephanie and anybody else that supports moving forward on this project after I implore you to please add more staff to the Planning Commission so we can move these things forward.
Great, thank you, but we don't let people add time to other people's, right, Les? Go ahead, Stephanie.
Good evening, commissioners. My name is Stephanie Kurzenhauser, and I'm a 10-year resident of Jennings Lodge area. I'm here tonight as an impassioned citizen who serves on the Jennings Lodge CPO board as president of the Friends of Oak Lodge Library, vice chair of the Oak Lodge Community Library Advocates, and perhaps most importantly, as a mother of four growing children. There is nothing that I care more about than the future of our community and efforts to improve geographic equity and amenities within the Oak Lodge area. I appeal to you this evening to still consider the scope of projects 1 through 4 in the attachment 3 planning options for the McLaughlin area. In light of Metro's regional transportation plans report that our county shall grow by 300,000 from 2005 to 2030, it becomes inarguable that intentional planning efforts and a concerted eye towards revitalization, economic growth, and housing are critical. Now is the time to conscientiously create a new model of partnership that allows citizens in concert with the county to drive and actualize a holistic model of growth that doesn't leave our most vulnerable behind. Family wage jobs, increased and affordable housing options, safeguards against gentrification and protection of current densities within our neighborhoods, economic growth, and natural areas and parks are the key integral pieces of MAP's goals, which have been delayed for years. Now is the time to capitalize on the convergence of myriad positive assets within our county. The new constellation of your administration, coupled with widespread excitement and community engagement within Oak Lodge, is a recipe for success. We want you to envision a dynamic partnership between CPOs, MAPIT, regional collaborators like Metro and PSU, the County Planning Division and other organizations, and community foot soldiers on the ground. Together, aided by a grant-funded third-party facilitator selected through an inclusive public process, we can begin the work of starting this year with a Park Avenue overlay and then moving thoughtfully down the boulevard in the years to come, node by node. You and we as a community have the chance to collectively change the trajectory, possibilities, and quality of life for future generations of Oak Lodge residents. The community is ready and willing to drive this process from the bottom up, and we thank you for your vision and willingness to embrace a model of revitalization that's inclusive, thoughtful, and conceptualizes development that is both economically and humanistically astute. Thank you very much for your time this evening, and thank you for your investment in our community. The dividends will indelibly enhance and improve the lives and futures of countless citizens in the years to come. That shall be your and our legacy together.
You see why I didn't speak?
Yes.
And I made it.
Thank
well
you.
Said.
Thank you. Mike Connors and Ed Gronke. You must be Mike. Where's Ed?
Must have been something I said.
Oh, Ed, you're up. Hi, Mike.
Thank you, Commissioners. My name is Mike Connors, Portland, Oregon, here on behalf of Embry Asset Group and Dollar General Stores. I'm here to testify on behalf of Project 15. That's the issue of considering exceptions to the 4,000 square foot limitation in rural commercial zones. It is one of the three items that the Planning Commission added to the staff recommendation. We're asking you to adopt the Planning Commission's recommendation on that item. As you may know, state law limits the size of commercial uses in rural commercial zones. There's a 4,000 square foot general limitation, but it's subject to exceptions that are adopted in administrative Oregon administrative rules that allow up to 8,000 square feet. In 2015, the county, as part of its ZDO audit, updated the rural commercial zones, and one of the issues it considers was this very issue. It was considering it, bringing it up to date so it was consistent with state law. Prior to 2015, there was a 4,000 square foot size limitation and an allowance for exceptions, but the exception process was different than what's under state law. It's more of a general variance process as opposed to the criteria that are recognized under state law. Planning Commission recommended the adoption of amendments that would be consistent with state law. And then when it got before this board in 2015, staff recommended that you table the issue of exceptions. And the idea was that staff felt that there should be a specific, more robust, standalone type of process or discussion of what kind of exceptions to adopt. And the board adopted that staff recommendation with the express purpose of revisiting this issue in a subsequent ZDO audit in 2015. Here we are about 2 years later. It still hasn't come up, and I think that's largely because of resource-related issues. But from our perspective, we believe that you should include it in the 2017-2018 work program for a variety of reasons. First of all, that was your express purpose, was to not defer it for perpetuity or to adopt a strict 4,000 square foot size limitation with no exceptions. It was to revisit it shortly and determine what kind of exceptions. Our concern is, you know, I've had some conversations with Mr. McCallister, you know, staff resources are always an issue. So if it's not this year, next year, same issue is going to come up. Ultimately, it's going to be a de facto strict 4,000 square foot limitation, which I don't believe this board intended to adopt in 2015. There really hasn't been a discussion on exceptions. Second issue is your code's inconsistent with state law and most other county codes. Most other county codes are consistent with state law. As I indicated, state law allows for these express exceptions. I think the county should at least be considering having a public process to consider adopting exceptions that were consistent with state law and most other county codes. And the third reason is that missed economic opportunities. My clients have a particular property that they're interested in. They are familiar with this rural commercial limitation, have dealt with it in other jurisdictions, and it wasn't until they understood the history of the 2015 that why Clackamas County was different. I think there's a lost opportunity there. And I think the only reason that staff initially didn't recommend our particular proposal was concern about staff resources. And that really comes down to whether you provide special notice, special outreach, or whether you have it go through the typical ZDO audit process like it did in 2015. We believe it's not necessary. It wasn't provided in 2015 when the county took away the exception. We don't believe it should be the reason for not revisiting the exception going forward. And there's really no requirement that you do it. And so the idea is there'll be a public process, people will be able to be notified, participate. We don't believe that, or I should say, without that special notice, I think staff indicated the Planning Commission there would be no staff resources or virtually very few staff resources that would be committed. So we're asking that you approve of the Planning Commission's recommendation to include Project 15, include it without special notice or outreach so that it doesn't overburden staff, And I appreciate the willingness to give me a little bit more time, and I'll answer any questions you may have.
Any questions? Oh, policy.
I just have one. So your client wants to do what activity on what size structure beyond 4,000 feet? So just enlighten me a little bit.
So they're looking at a property in Rhododendron, and it would be for a dollar general store, and it would be roughly about 7,500 square feet.
Okay, so it's not tourism then?
I'm sorry?
It's not tourism.
Oh, it's marked tourism commercial in here.
So item 15 is for tourism purposes.
Well, no, item 15 relates to rural tourist commercial zones as well as rural commercial. That's where the tourist is coming. This RTC and the RC zone is where this particular limitation applies. So it is Project 15, but I understand the confusion with the reference to the okay. tourist.
Okay, thank you.
I get it. Okay, well, we'll look at it. I mean,
Mr. Chairman?
I don't know much about it. Yes.
Come on, Mr. Connors. Like, I think you framed the issue well. I might have to have a jump, but I don't think the exception ever existed. But it was when we were doing part of the audit, and we were looking at bringing that provision.
We were looking about bringing that provision in to be consistent with state law. Our concern then is the same concern that we have now, is that there is in those rural unincorporated Colton and Rhododendron and Redland and all that, those places where there's rural commercial zoning, is that there is the 4,000 square foot building limitation, maximum size. So I think there's two paths forward for the board to consider. One, if you wanted to incorporate this into part of an audit package of the zoning ordinance, we could do that. We would give general notice to CPOs and interested parties. We could incorporate it into one amendment as part of the ZDO package. That's a path we could do. It basically would fold into project number one that we have recommended now. It's not a significant impact on staffing resources. So that's one option. The other option is that we would directly notify all the property owners in those unincorporated communities, Colton, Redland, Welch's, Rhododendron, all those things, say, you know, is there interest in having larger buildings out there? And do they change kind of the character of those areas? And do you want those? And from our staff's perspective, if you take that second path, then it becomes a much larger project. It would be something that we would have to add on to the project and probably take something off, because if you're talking about notifying a lot of property owners, responding to phone calls, you know, all those kind of things. But it's the board's choice.
In the other case, if a project was proposed, they'd still have to go through a process of community notice and all that if you did it through the zoning and development ordinance audit. If a project was proposed, they still have to go through the process.
Still have to go through the process, but right. So the first path is we would just fold it into the audit. But yes, it would come before the Planning Commission and the board for consideration. The second alternative, it's the same process, except that we would actually notify the property owners directly that are in those communities.
Okay. Ken?
Without speaking to the merits of whether or not we should or shouldn't do it, or what methods that we would use to approve or not approve, as the case may be, my concern is that it's been languishing for 2 years. I think that the business is entitled to a definitive answer so that they can move on one way or the other. And that's my only concern, so I'm hoping that we will simply get it done. Whatever we ultimately decide in terms of whether it should be expanded, at least you will know what you can or can't do, and you can move forward.
Well, I think that putting in a zoning development ordinance audit would be the best way to go, and then the community can, I see heads nodding. Any rural people nodding their heads? Okay, there's some rural people nodding their heads. Okay. Okay. All right.
You can consider that in your motions and decision.
Okay. All right, thank you. Ed.
Chair Bernard, members of the commission, good evening. My name is Ed Gronke. I live at 4912 Southeast Reynerson Road, Jennings Lodge. I'm here tonight as the chair of the McLaughlin Area Plan Implementation Team, otherwise known as MAPIT. I'm here to advocate for the commission to approve the work plan as submitted by the Planning Division. For us, it's sort of a culmination of a discussion, a conversation that we started having with Mike McCallister and his staff almost 2 years ago. And I know that there were good reasons not to have it in the work plan last year, and we don't dispute those at all. But I'm really pleased to see that the work is beginning. I think it's an extremely good idea to look for grant assistance. I'm pleased to hear that Mike is offering to work with us on helping to craft the grant. I would be very much in favor of a separate consultant. I think, I'm sure you're keeping in mind the fact that if you go that route, it will not be done within a year. Knowing the rules that have to be followed and even retaining a consultant, if you said yes tonight, it would be at least 3 to 4 months before you would have someone ready to start. But in any case, we stand ready to help in any way we can, and I hope you can approve what Mike has submitted.
Thank you. All right, thank you. So Karen, I think it's Karen, and Bill Merchant. How do you pronounce your last name?
Bjorklund.
Just like it's spelled.
Exactly.
It is actually. Thank you. Go ahead.
I'm going to try to put this where you can see that. Hello, my name is Karen Bjorklund, and some people bring hats or wear extra hats. I have nameplates. So I have nameplates for two different organizations I'm representing this evening. As the chair of the Jennings Lodge Community Planning Organization, I want to thank the planning staff, the Planning Commission, and all the commissioners who've been working so diligently this year on issues to help revitalize McLaughlin area and to preserve the neighborhood around that. And we look forward to that future and working with you on that future. Now switching nameplates. On behalf of the CPO Summit, I'm here with a number of colleagues from the CPO Summit to talk about three proposals that we made to planning. As you may know, the CPO Summit is an ad hoc group of CPOs. At this point, we've got about two-thirds of the active CPOs together talking about issues that are important to all of us, rural and urban CPOs, both. And we created a list of priorities, and to start on that top priorities list, we had made three proposals. So I'm going to talk about the first two, and my colleagues are going to talk about the other ones. One of the proposals, which is part of number 20 in your packet, was asking that the county email notifications to CPOs about land use applications, rather than just putting them in the postal mail. And at the February Planning Commission meeting, Mike McCallister made a promise that he would work with staff to go ahead and do that. So we want to thank Mike for that, and we're looking forward to that happening. In the second proposal, which is number 12 in your packet, we ask that CPOs be able to appeal hearings officer decisions locally to a body who understands the local issues and is looking out for the local needs and interests. Again, at the Planning Commission meeting, where we obviously talked about these things, we had a good discussion about various kinds of approaches. The commissioners all got involved, Mike McCallister got involved, and we also got some good feedback after the meeting from the members who gave us some ideas, some information we could gather that would kind of give an idea of what the scope is and what kinds of hearings might come up. And if we could get that information, then we could figure out how to pinpoint a process that worked on those exact issues. So we have some homework to do, is the bottom line on that. So we will do our homework, we'll gather information, and we'll come back to you when we've kind of scoped that out in a lot more detail. But we got some really good feedback from everyone so far, so we know what to do. That leaves one more proposal, one issue, and it's also part of number 20 in your packet that we still want to talk to you about. The CPOs are asking for earlier notification of land use applications, and my colleagues will talk about the rest, but there's just one thing I want to say about this. This planning process and planning proposal process is actually the only formal process, the only formal invitation that we're given to submit general proposals or general issues. We don't have another one. So even if this third item, which might very well be administrative in detail, even if it's administrative, we don't have anywhere else to submit that. So that's partly why we're doing this, is this part of the process. So something you might want to consider for future is whether there's another process you might want to have that offers CPOs in the community an opportunity to give other kinds of things that aren't just strictly land use and comprehensive plan oriented. So I'll thank you for your time and your considerations. I can answer any general questions you might have about the CPO summit or those first two proposals, and I'll let the other.
Well, I've never heard of the CPO summit, so it'd be, I never heard of it. That's great.
We just started meeting last November, so that it's not a long running thing. We just got it running pretty shortly.
So one thing is that we have been getting a consistent bunch of emails from Susan Hansen, who would like some. She had some ideas and some proposals that community. I know that Ken has been getting those emails too, and one of those is website notification. Email's a great idea if we have everybody's email, but just something on the web page that might pertain to various communities. And she gave some ideas, and I was driving, so I couldn't actually look at my email when I talked to her. So that's some stuff we'll be looking at. Ken?
Well, I saw your requests in our packet today, and it dovetailed with some requests that Ms. Hansen was making, so I spoke with Gary Schmidt at PGA and asked him to take a look at this and see what we could do, and suggested that he speak to Mr. McCallister, and if there's a legal issue that has to be addressed, to also talk to our county council to make sure that we don't cross any inappropriate lines. So we are looking at it. I'm not sure what can be done at this point, but at least I can tell you that some efforts being made to look at it.
Would you also want to send her my way so we can connect up with her and what her ideas are?
I'll let Mr. Schmidt know about that, okay. and he can contact you.
Great.
Chair Bernard?
Yes.
Can I respond to one thing? Because I did commit to looking at, when we get land use applications in, they're reviewed by a planner, to the extent they're deemed complete, those land use applications don't go back to our permit specialists. They do the appropriate mailing, they scan them, they put them on our Excel, our permit system, where they can be viewed. One of the requests was, and that the hard copy of that application will go to the CPOs, but you know, it's a couple days to get it in the mail, and if it's the weekend, it's a little longer. So one of the requests was that once we've deemed it complete and it's sent out for notice, just to email the application to the CPO. And I apologize, because I meant to respond, so I talked with our permit specialist, and we're doing that beginning last Monday, and I meant to actually send an email out to you to inform you of that, and I just haven't got there, but I will do that so the rest of CPOs know. So once we deem the application complete and it's getting mailed out, our permit specialist will attach that application to an email, send it to the appropriate CPO, you'll get that, and you'll be able to distribute that to your members accordingly. I only caution that some of the applications are this big, and people's computers blow up, or you know, all that kind of stuff. So there will be some logistics if we get, you know, most of them are very doable, but if you get to very voluminous applications, sometimes people have a hard time, but we can work through that. But you should start getting those now.
Okay, thank you.
So does the law require mailing?
Yes.
Okay, so you can't get around saving money by not mailing and doing it all internet. Okay. Yeah. That might be something we want to work on at the legislature, because times have changed.
Someday.
Yeah, okay. Because my understanding is that you send out a big envelope that goes to the CPO, right?
The hard copy
of
the application is mailed.
Okay, so it's just one application. You don't send out notice, and then the CPO has to get that to the membership. Well, that's what I got the impression in my voice message occurred. You actually just send the main application, then send you send a mailer to those people that will be affected by whatever.
We send a copy of the application to the CPO, and then we send just a notice of the application, but not the application materials, to the surrounding property owners.
Okay.
And then there's a link, they can get where there's links and stuff where they can go view it on our webpage.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right, thanks. Bill?
Thank you, Commissioner Bernard and the rest of you commissioners. My name is Bill Merchant, and I live in Beaver Creek, and I'm representing the hamlet of Beaver Creek, which also takes on CPO duties for Beaver Creek. And everybody's still in my thunder here. I was going to say that the reason for Oregon's goal one of citizen involvement is because the public lives on the land and knows firsthand what land use changes will mean for them. We need the expertise and the guidance of planning staff. They do an amazing job with over 20,000 applications last year. But they don't know the 1,883 square miles of Clackamas County like the people who live on those square miles. When the planning process came into being, CPOs were created to create citizen involvement. And CPOs are charged with advising planning staff and even yourselves about the effect of local land use, but we can't do that unless we get timely notice. The state has timelines by which land use decisions must be rendered of 120 or 150 days based on circumstances, and the clock starts running when the application is accepted and deemed complete. Currently, 86% of land use decisions are issued within 60 days by DTD, and they're hoping to move that to 45 days. And that's wonderful for everybody who's trying to get something done in Clackamas County, but it's still a very short timeline, and CPOs don't get notice and can't get notice fast enough. As the county moves forward with more applications on Acela and e-permitting and things like that, more of that information is available online. If we can get an email that refers to the application on Acela, we'll be glad to go there ourselves on the website and look at the application rather than having to receive this giant email. But it's a matter of timing. Yes, there's the legal requirement to mail to us. We can't get around that yet. But if we get notice fast, that's wonderful. Thank you, Mike. That's all I have to say.
Great, thank you. Steve Graper and Marge Stewart. Oh.
I was wondering.
I mean, yes.
I was wondering if Mike could actually speak to the notice aspect. If that may be by at least use of email, that there would be notice of notice, if you will, at the very minimum. That way, if there is a mailing, for example, that the mailing takes 3 or 4 days to go, in the mail, that the email notice might expedite or draw attention to the fact that something's coming.
Right.
So I just wondered if there was that opportunity via email to the to the contact.
And so that's what I was talking about. When the application is deemed complete right now, and it's scanned and it's all ready to go, at that point in time, we will send an email to the CPO and attach the application. And then it will probably get dropped in the mail the same day to the CPO, but it'll be a couple other days before they get it. Does that answer your question?
Well, I'm just wondering if that's really satisfying the request, because we're talking about number 12 and number 20.
Right.
So we're really talking about both, really, in that context, right? Because 12 was the land use application planning notice piece, and the other one was the notice by email. So is that request being knocked out, both 12 and 20?
I think so.
Okay.
Yeah.
And Steve, I just wanted you to know that we went to government camp, both Ken and I, unanimous support of you becoming probably the largest CPO in the United States of America. I'm just kidding. But, I mean, they were, I guess they had had approval a number of years back.
Back in 2012, correct.
Yeah. So, congratulations. Thank
you. Well, it's not a done deal yet. You guys haven't pounded the gavel down on it yet. Okay, so, we're still in the information gathering process from the communities. But I'm not here about the rhododendron's CPO boundary change. I am here about the Planning Commission and some policies and procedures, which, the, as Mr. Merchant said, the wind has been knocked out of our sails a little bit by some of the things that that you have discussed, and we appreciate that very much, Mike. I had this 3 minute and 45 second document that I was going to read, but the bottom line comes down to the fact that there are a number of CPOs out there, and we at the summit have been discussing items of concern and mutual interest to all CPOs, and the unanimous vote of all of the CPOs there was that we were not getting a consistent or timely notification on land use issues or applications. And you seem to be now addressing that, and so we appreciate that. If we can get, because there are so many CPOs that don't have a whole lot of land use issues, we don't want to have a meeting for meeting's sake. We meet maybe bi-monthly or once every quarter. If a land use issue comes available, the CPOs that don't meet on a regular basis need to get a timely notification, because if a land use issue comes in the day after, say for example, rhododendron CPO, we meet bi-monthly, we get a land use issue that comes in or an application that comes in several days after our bi-monthly meeting, the comment period sometimes falls before our next CPO meeting. And if we could maintain a consistent policy of obtaining notification through email, just as Mr. Merchant had alluded to, then we as CPOs will be able to act under Senate Bill 100 and in Goal 1 to be able to obtain the citizen comments that is required through SB 100 and Goal 1. And so we appreciate that, Mike, and we look forward to your staff coming up with some kind of a policy that will then notify CPOs on a timely basis, a consistent basis, and perhaps set policy where we are notified as soon as an application is deemed complete. Okay. That's it. Thank you very much, commissioners. Oh, my name is Stephen Graper, and I am the chair of the Rhododendron CPO. That was it. The first sentence in this.
You can just hold that up. I have a photographic memory. I see it.
Thank you very much, commissioners.
Thanks. Go ahead.
Okay. I'm Marge Stewart. I'm the president of Furwood CPO. My address is 49025 Southeast Wildcat Mountain Road, Sandy address. And yes, thanks for everything that everybody's already said. It's there. Part of my point was what we've all been saying. You know, some of our CPOs cover a lot of distance, and okay, a recent example, I got the notice of a hearing, and when I saw it, I thought, hey, that seems kind of neat, but there was no time to get it to our CPO meeting or to go to the people who were the neighbors to find out what their opinion was. So I went to the hearing, and as the hearing progressed, I thought, what is this? And a lot of neighbors were there testifying, were opposing it. And so if we'd had more time, I should have, would have, perhaps. They didn't know anything about going to the CPO. They didn't have any idea. We're working hard on getting more people aware of where they are, what part of this whole thing they're part of. You know, and we need to keep working on that. But at the same time, what you're doing was going to be our request to get more advance notice. So then maybe I could go out and meet those people, and before the hearing, we as CPO could support, or you know, whatever seems to be the right thing to do. And, you know, working together, which is, we're all in this together. And great. Yeah, and on that, both Steve and I independently did get some newspaper coverage of what our CPOs were. Just happened to come out at the same time. And we'd been working on it for some time, but anyway, I guess, yeah, it's most all been said, and thank you.
Great. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Chair Bernard, just a couple follow-up comments. One, so yes, we'll commit to sending an email as soon as the application's complete. Also, when the notice is mailed out, there is a 21-day comment period. That's what the notice says, okay? And I want to, and some of you know this, but I want to clarify that that's a minimum comment period. So we say you have 21 days to comment on the application. What that means is we will not issue a decision within that 21-day period, okay? However, it's not uncommon that we don't issue a decision for 30 days or 35 days or 40 days. It's a minimum time. Some very simple applications, we will turn them around pretty quick. But I always encourage CPOs, if you have a CPO meeting 3 days after the deadline, call the staff person and say, we're going to have a meeting in 3 days. Can you hold off on the application until we get, most cases we can do that. There are circumstances where we can't because we have to meet some deadlines and anticipated appeals and that sort of thing. But I always encourage you to call the staff person, and if you need a couple days and you're having a meeting, we can generally accommodate that. You just need to let us know. The other thing in terms of notifying CPOs, we require pre-application conferences for certain types of applications, not all. But any significant application, particularly ones that go to the public, to the hearings officer, so conditional use permits, partitions, subdivisions, zone change applications, comp plans, those sort of things, you're required to have a pre-application conference with the staff before you can turn the application in. At those meetings, we routinely encourage those folks to go talk to the CPO before they turn in an application to identify their issues and to let them know what's coming. There are other types of applications that don't require pre-applications, temporary permits and home occupations that don't require it. So if it is appealed to the hearings officer, that pre-application conference hasn't happened, so you wouldn't hear about that until the notice of the public hearing comes out. But there are instances where all our design review applications, commercial, industrial, multifamily, require pre-apps, and we give the folks the contact information for CPO, and we encourage them to go talk to those folks.
Paul? I just want to say before I lose the opportunity to, I just want to just acknowledge all the volunteer work that these CPO folks do on our behalf. They're doing it for free, and they're working with staff. And I want to acknowledge and thank staff as well for working with the CPOs. But there's a lot of work to this, and being a member of the CPO for 20 years now, I know what this is all about. I know that sometimes in the evenings when you have your meetings, sometimes you have to take time off of work because some of you have jobs. But I do appreciate you all being here tonight and all the work that you do across the county. So thank you.
Yeah, thanks. Next is Chips and Cindy Lewis Wolfram. Chips? Cindy? I feel like we're coming to a kumbaya moment here.
I've heard about those.
Thank you for coming tonight.
Mr. Chairman, commissioners, my name is Chips Janger. I'm a citizen of Oak Grove. And also, I'm one of the founders of Urban Green. In 2009, Urban Green, 2009, after the previous BCC, along with Milwaukee and Portland and TriMet and Metro approved the alignment for the Orange Line, Urban Green applied for a Nature in the Neighborhoods grant for the Park Avenue Station to make it the greenest and most economically economically, but what we were talking about actually is sustainable. The most sustainable light rail station anywhere. And we were pretty successful. It has four ecosystems, and it filters all the water from that area, as well as we received a grant from ODOT to filter all the water up McLaughlin Boulevard. Portland State did a case study because we had gathered the community together to actually create the design and the concept of the whole thing. It's kind of an outstanding community project, and Portland State wrote a case study describing it, and they've continued this. One of the things they asked at the time was, of course, when, and they were interested in seeing, this is Portland State, and their planning department was interested in seeing how they were going to create an economic area around it by creating a light rail station zoning overlay. That hasn't happened. They were surprised it didn't happen, and it still hasn't happened. The station's been open for 3 years, and we have asked, and I understand the planning department has been overtaxed, but we are excited that there is something that is beginning, because we've been waiting for a long time. One of the things that happened while we were waiting is that citizens from every active group around, from all the CPOs, have continued doing the work themselves. We have a lot of people from each of the CPOs, from Jennings Lodge as well as from Oak Grove, young architects around from the area, people from business people around from the area. Many active citizens have continued, have worked, and have been making these kinds of contributions themselves, as well as creating overlay possibilities, showing how it could be done, researching overlays and light rail stations all around, and this work is continuing on. One of the things we're excited about is that we're excited about working with the planning department, with the BCC, to show the work we've done in conjunction with a consultant so that we could hopefully move this along. Our concern is that if it isn't moved along, it's going to be years, literally years, before there are actually changes and before we have a light rail area that actually can begin to do things to take advantage of the fact that there's a billion and a quarter piece of infrastructure that ended up in our community in which the county has yet to do anything about to promote. The citizens of the area, however, have been doing things. We look forward to working with the commission and the planning department to actually begin some of the work as soon as we can. We've sent materials to you to show how it can be done. We know it can be done. We think most of it can be done in a 12-month period. So we're looking forward to working with you to see what can be done. Thank you.
You know, you're going to make me give Les an extra minute. He's already gone. Yes. Cindy?
Good evening, commissioners. My name is Cindy Lewis Wolfram. I am the chair of the Clackamas CPO, and which contains the little portion of Clackamas and the little portion of Milwaukee that's kind of the bedroom community to the very active CPOs up the hill. We are here in support of all the suggestions that have been made by both the CPO Summit. As a member of the CPO Summit, I've seen some very cooperative work there, trying to make sure that the CPOs are doing what they were actually supposed to be doing by working together. But also the MAPIT group and the two CPOs up the hill who are pulling together to get all this work done in that area of McLaughlin. That will, getting all that, all the work that is needed to be done on McLaughlin is going to bring us to a more prosperous position in that area of the community. I want to encourage you looking at number 12 once again. There was a very sad situation that happened in my CPO a couple years ago, but also a happy one. It was one that we've learned to live with in our little neighborhood, where the development of a process of a new community of higher end houses wasn't let known to us until it was going to the hearings officer, and just right before the hearings officer. And we brought that community and their objections in. And I'm sorry to say that we lost several members of our community who left because of that development, because there was no understanding of what was going on in that area. And I would encourage and keep encouraging Mike to keep the earlier notice going on, but also giving us a little more participation along in the hearing situation so that we can bring the concerns of the surrounding neighborhood to that area as well. And the third thing that I really wanted to say tonight was, in support of the CPOs, is one word, and that's insurance. I know that there's probably not enough money for us to do something about it right now, but you have people out there putting their reputations and lives and aside while they work for that community. They're not earning a living at it, like several people in this room are. But we need to make sure that their lives are protected. There's got to be something, since they work for this county, that can be done. And I would encourage you to look for it this year, even if we can't afford it yet, because we should be able to afford it soon. Thank you.
We are going to be having that discussion not next week, the week after, right?
The 28th, you are correct.
Wonderful.
Yeah, thanks.
Thank you, Chairman.
Les Poole, you have 3.5 minutes.
I will try and be done in under 3. Thank you. Yeah, 10 years ago when it started, there was no light rail, and it was a different world. And I do want to thank all the citizens and staff and everyone through the years that's tried to do something with McLaughlin Boulevard. And when we talk about McLaughlin Boulevard and we talk about improving it and making changes at Park Avenue, we've got some constraints and we've got an existing environment. The 25 units per acre may not work. I understand that. And obviously in a station area, if we start looking at higher density, the number 60 is always thrown out. There ought to be a number in between the two. 60 units per acre is probably going to overwhelm the side streets. McLaughlin, regardless of what we do along its shoulders, is still a state highway. It's a connector. It's a commerce strip. I'd love to see things change there, but we're going to have to be real careful about where we spend money. And in trying to preserve the neighborhoods, which I fully support, I'm talking about the residential areas, we're going to have to address that spillover traffic. And I haven't heard the word safety at Park Avenue. I know it's underneath everyone's thoughts. We've had an increasing number of accidents there. I've commented on a couple of different occasions. So no matter what we do, we need to work on traffic safety in general. And I know that's part of what MAPIT's trying to achieve. And I just want to make sure that it's really integrated with everything we do. I also have a question. And I say this just as a general question, not seeking an immediate answer. How are we going to have more room for trees? What's going to happen to our trees? That's a touchy subject. The trees have not been brought up. We're going to cut trees down. Things are going to change. But I've got concerns when we talk about preserving and helping the environment. There's a point where we start to turn things upside down in a neighborhood. So you got your work in front of you. I'm certainly not here to oppose things I've heard. I would close by saying I'm fully with the folks that have talked about the notification process. There ought to be a way that when you're going to have a pre-app conference, a notice goes out to the CPO, maybe. A lot of times folks don't check their mail. A lot of times people don't know what's going on until it's too late. But some of that notification and outreach needs to come from the CPO to the neighborhood. I don't know how many actual citizens outside of CPO members are participating in this. We got 30,000 people in Oak Grove. We got 400,000 people in the county. They're obviously not all going to weigh in at the same time. I don't expect you to send a notice to everyone every time something comes down the pike. But things that could be done to improve notice and improve citizen involvement, goal one, would be great. And I will cede the rest of my time to Commissioner Bernard.
I heard you volunteer to chair the tree committee, tree ordinance.
I will do that.
Really?
Oh, gladly, gladly. Thank you.
Great. All right, what did I want to say? All right, so any other questions of staff or comments? So I got to find out where I am. So I'd entertain a motion, but the motion should include adding item 15, building size in rural tourist commercial zones. If you make a motion.
Yes, Mr. Chairman, I move we approve the Clackamas County Long-Range Planning Work Program for 2017-18 and that it include item 15.
Second.
Okay, it's been moved and second to approve Clackamas County's long-range planning work plan for 2017-18, including item 15. Any further discussion?
Just want to clarify, the motion is the staff recommendation with the two added amendments, as Mike McCallister stated earlier today.
Okay. Number four.
Yes, okay. Right. I mean, basically, as you verbalized today and reviewed. Yes, okay.
Okay, any further discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Abstaining? Hearing none. Thank you all for coming tonight. Thanks. Okay, so we have another discussion item, I think. No, it's a previous heard land use issue. And
yes, Mr. Chair, this is a consideration of a board order related to a previously denied comprehensive plan map amendment and zone change application. And Mr. Madkour will talk with you about this item.
That's correct. Thank you, Stephen Madkour, County Council. Last December, this board, in a prior composition of members, voted to deny an application for a comp plan amendment and associated zone change. The vote was 3-2. Former members Chair Ludlow and Commissioner Smith voted on that. The vote was 3-2 to deny it. We need to have formal findings adopted to allow this to be concluded. And if the applicant wants to appeal it, we would need to have the formal findings, and we need to do this within 120 days. This was a remand from LUBA. And so what we need from the board tonight is an affirmative vote adopting these findings, and we're going to need Commissioner Savas to vote in favor of this, even though he voted to support the applicant's application in December. So he's not necessarily voting in favor of, we're not revisiting the vote in December, we're just formalizing that particular vote in December. And so new commissioners Fisher and Humberson are not voting on this and cannot vote on this because they did not hear this matter, which was a evidentiary matter in a land use public hearing. I know it sounds a little bit complex, there is a twist to it, but what you are doing is memorializing something that happened in December to allow this application to be closed and to allow them to appeal if they want to.
Okay, any questions?
So my question is, if we don't approve this, they don't have an opportunity to appeal, which is what
That is correct. Right. Okay. They wouldn't. You need to have a final written order. And that's what this is. This board order has associated findings with it as well. And the board order and findings both reflect the votes that took place in December.
Okay. So I'll entertain a motion.
I move we approve the board order related to a previously denied comprehensive plan map amendment and zone change application.
Is there a second?
I'll second it.
It's been moved and seconded to approve the board order relating to the previous denied comprehensive plan map amendment and zone change application. Any further discussion?
Yes, I just want to, understanding this is a procedural thing, and I don't want to get the way the procedural, so I just want to just state that, somewhat as Mr. Madkour has outlined, that the composition of this board has changed since December, and the new members were not involved in the prior board's decision. So accordingly, to ratify the board's earlier actions and to move this matter forward and to provide the applicant with a final order, I will be voting in favor of these or favor of adopting these written findings, despite the fact that I had voted in favor of approving the plan amendment.
Thank you.
Okay. Any other discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Abstaining.
I'm abstaining.
Aye.
Abstain.
Oh, you're abstaining.
No. Well, I didn't get a chance to cast my vote because I had gotten up. But I'm voting in favor of
of abstaining.
You have to abstain because you weren't involved in this.
I abstain in that case.
It's that one.
It's that one, okay. Because I read the material, so I figured, but okay.
Oh, yeah, that's true.
So for the record, it was Commissioner Schrader, Savas, and Bernard voting in favor of adopting these written findings, and it was Commissioner Fisher and Humberston abstaining because they were not part of the hearing process.
Thank you, Commissioners.
We might have wanted to poll on that one because it's awkward. Okay, with that, we'll move on to the consent agenda.
Okay, the consent agenda. Under Health, Housing, and Human Services, approval of an intergovernmental agreement with Gladstone School District for Kindergarten Parent Partnership Innovation Services, approval of an intergovernmental agreement with Clackamas Education Service District for Kindergarten Partnership Innovation Services, approval of a local subrecipient agreement with Oregon Children's Foundation, Start Making a Reader Today for Kindergarten Partnership Innovation Services, approval of an intergovernmental agreement with Oregon City School District for Kindergarten Partnership Innovation Services, approval of an intergovernmental agreement with Oregon Trail School District for Kindergarten Partnership Innovation Services, and approval of a subrecipient grant agreement with Northwest Family Services for alcohol and drug prevention for at-risk or high-risk youth. Under the Department of Transportation and Development, approval of an intergovernmental agreement between North Clackamas Parks and Recreation District and Clackamas County Department of Transportation and Development to provide assistance in construction management services related to repairing the Casa del Rey Bridge at North Clackamas Park. Under elected officials, approval of previous business meeting minutes, and a request by the Clackamas County Sheriff's Office to accept a grant subrecipient award from Clackamas Women's Services for improving the county's criminal justice response through a Safe Place Family Justice Center. Under Business and Community Services, approval of a county opportunity grant for the Friar Park Campground Restroom Replacement from the Oregon Parks and Recreation Department. A resolution authorizing Clackamas County Parks to apply for a local government grant from the Oregon Parks and Recreation Department for replacement of a restroom at Barton Park. Under North Clackamas Parks and Recreation District, approval of an intergovernmental agreement with North Clackamas Parks and Recreation District and Clackamas County Department of Transportation and Development to provide assistance in construction management services related to repairing the Casa del Rey Bridge at North Clackamas Park. And Water Environment Services, approval of an agreement between Clackamas County Service District Number 1 and the City of Happy Valley for assignment of conservation easement. And that concludes tonight's consent agenda.
I'll entertain a motion.
I move we accept the consent agenda.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded to approve the consent agenda. Any further discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Motion carries. Okay, with that, we'll move on to administrator update.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I've just got a couple of items. One of the things I wanted to share with you is that our Beaver Creek Health Clinic started offering acupuncture treatment services just about 6 months ago. And actually, the treatment's been very, very popular there. We, within the first month, the class was full. And I'm told that our clinic staff were amazed by the responsiveness of the patients to this form of pain management treatment for them. In all, we have had some 368 appointments since last September. And I just wanted to thank our health clinics and our partner in this program, the National University of Natural Medicine. I also have some good news for Water Environment Services. They had the Rock Creek Watershed event held last Saturday. We had some 70 volunteers who planted more than 1,350 plants and trees at three different sites along Rock Creek. The event also provided participants with education about the importance of watershed health, and the funding for the event came from our Water Environment Services River Health Stewardship Program. And I wanted to thank our partners, Friends of Trees, Clackamas River Basin Council, and the dig-in community. So thank you.
Great, thank you. Next up, Sonia, you're up.
For Commissioner Communications?
Yes.
Thank you, Chair Bernard. I continue my orientation to our county departments and services, and I'm feeling quite a bit of pressure because we have our board retreat on Monday and Tuesday. So I very much focused my questions to how can we, what are the strategic investments that we as a board should look at as we look at what our goals are. So I've been very enlightened and pleased with the different conversations I've had from business and community services to health, housing, human services, and just around the county in looking at all that we do and where we can focus our efforts. I'm also looking forward to heading up to the mountain this Saturday for the CPO meeting, and we've sent out an invitation to anyone who wants to join at 8 a.m. at Trail 742, the west, I think it's west, it's the Salmon River Trail, and it's a beautiful hike. It's a beautiful, and I'm going to be there rain or shine, and anybody who wants to join can come along as well.
You're going to need snowshoes. There's 3 feet of snow there.
Is there now?
No. There is a little bit of snow in the woods, but not much.
It was like 15 feet.
Martha, you're up next.
Yeah, I just want to talk. I think that Commissioner Savas may add a little bit to this, but we both had the opportunity on Friday to hear Dr. Matthew Desmond, and he is a doctor at Harvard University. And he is the author of Evicted, and let's see if I can get the full title here. I thought around it. Author of Evicted, Poverty and Profit in the American City. So he's done a groundbreaking work, and so I was just going to read a quick paragraph from the Kirkus Review. They said about the book, a groundbreaking work on the central role of housing in the lives of the poor. Based on 2 years spent embedded with eight poor families in Milwaukee, and that isn't here, this is Milwaukee, Wisconsin, Desmond delivers a gripping novelistic narrative exploring the ceaseless cycle of making rent, delaying eviction, or finding another place to live when homeless, as experienced by adults and children, both black and white, surviving in trailer parks and ghettos. We have failed to fully appreciate how deeply housing is implicated in the creation of poverty, writes the author. Once rare, eviction is now commonplace for millions of Americans each year, most often as a result of insufficient government support, rising rent and utility costs, and stagnant incomes. He was a riveting speaker. I would hope that people can get a copy of the book. You know, you can download it on your Kindle, which I did, or a hard copy. Once again, it's Dr. Matthew Desmond, Evicted, Poverty, and Profit in the American City. And since we as commissioners, I think, have been dedicated to helping to solve the housing crisis, not just in Clackamas County in the region, it's a really informative, good read. I haven't been able to put it down, so it'll be some of my night reading tonight. Also, I'd like to mention I had the opportunity to go down to Salem to testify, but also to meet with Dr. Adrienne Allen again of the Oregon Manufacturing Innovation Council. Those were the folks I visited in England. Dr. Allen actually has come out here as the legislature works to implement that model here in our region. So we're watching it because we think it's going to have implications for Clackamas Community College as well as Oregon Tech, both of whom are in Clackamas County. Also on Saturday, I got to attend the Rock Creek Watershed event, which was organized by Water and Environment Services. It was a great event, and people went out in the pouring rain. They were very, very brave to help do restoration work in that area out in Happy Valley, and I was just privileged to have them ask me to come and say a few words. And I've been to the Pendarvis Farm, where the event was held numerous times, and it was great to go back there again. So there's more. Oh, let me do the arts and culture activities. Actually, can I ask, maybe Commissioner Fisher would like to do this.
On the 23rd annual airing of the quilts, the Milwaukee Center Quilt Show is a community quilt show. There will be a lecture on Saturday on taming your scraps. It's Friday and Saturday, March 17th and 18th from 9 a.m. to 4 p.m. at the Milwaukee Center. There's Canby, Music in the Stacks. How do you say this?
Celtic?
No, it's supposed to be
Beltane.
Okay.
Beltane.
This word?
Beltane.
Beltane, the Northwest premier Celtic fusion band, just in time for St. Patrick's Day, Saturday, March 18th, 2:30 at Canby Public Library. For more information about any event, go to the Arts Alliance website, clackamasartsalliance.org.
Great. Okay. Mr. Humberston.
Well done, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you.
I just have one brief comment to make. And during the course of the campaign, unfortunately, we had the unfortunate experience of having to see CPOs that were not well-disciplined, well-organized, well-led, and speaking with a single voice to represent their communities. What we have seen, that you and I both had the privilege of seeing the other day and today, is CPOs that are, in fact, well-led, well-organized, well-disciplined, and speaking with one voice. And I appreciate seeing that because it makes it much easier for us to do our job and meet the needs of the communities. We have no interest in getting in the middle of squabbles because it's counterproductive for everybody. So to see the kind of leadership I've seen in the last couple of days, I really appreciate it. So Steve, sitting in the audience, thank you very much. I don't remember the gentleman's name who led the government camp one, but he deserves kudos also. Very effective.
Nick.
That's correct. So thank you for providing effective leadership in your communities. It's very much appreciated. Thank you.
Great. Commissioner Savas.
Thank you, Chair. I will just want to just speak a little bit to the presentation today by staff and their hard work on trying to iron all this out. And I'm appreciative of the board's support for the assessment of the area, knowing that everything will be happening as far as the study work in the area. And I want to say that it is really study work. And I really felt that it was important that if the Park Avenue commercial strip examination was going to happen, that it was really important to make sure an assessment of the area in concert with the protecting of the neighborhoods and neighborhood overlays was important. So we need to assess the current conditions. And what that really means really is, and my concern has been about gentrification to the point of rents increasing more rapidly than people can actually afford. And so, and other community issues as well that go right along with that. So you can't really protect the neighborhoods unless you really establish what the status quo is now. How many people are in jeopardy? What are the current conditions? So this is something that very sophisticated planning organizations along the West Coast that I have talked to have done in order to basically do no harm. And that's really the principle there. So I'm grateful that we've established that. The one thing that I haven't got a lot of comfort about as of yet, and I know a couple of our folks spoke to it today, was about employment, because they spoke to trying to address some of the employment needs. And I think that's important. And it's the kind of employment I think that a lot of people that are in their 40s or 50s, and maybe they didn't get a college education, but they had once a very high-paying job that didn't really have a lot of skill requirements, but they really adopted and learned those skills, but their industry went away or their job went away. Those are the kinds of folks we're putting back to work. But unfortunately, Metro does not offer, at least by what my conversation with Counselor Collette has been, they don't offer a grant for employment. So I'm hoping that with our efforts, staff, and the community, we can find something that will address that employment need, because it's so, so important for those folks. As some people put it, it doesn't matter if the rent goes from $500 to $1,000 or it goes from $1,000 to $1,500. It doesn't matter because I don't even have $500 because I don't have a job. So when you hear that kind of reaction from folks, then it really kind of brings home the plight that we're trying to deal with. On Sunday, I'll be meeting with Commissioner Fisher, and we will be driving the area, and I will be showing her a similar tour that I gave Commissioner Humberston and former Commissioner Ann Leininger of the area, so they can kind of understand what we're combating in the area, what we're trying to deal with in the area. I wish I could have attended last Saturday. I think I've been to every Pendarvis Farm watershed event, most of them being wet, because it's that time of year. I usually get drenched, but out there planting trees, and it's very cool because there's so much youth involved. And I think I really enjoy that, the fact that youth is so involved in this. And it's a great farm, and it's really great that the Pendarvis family has really offered up their property for that. But I was not able to attend because of a family commitment, and this weekend, and I talked to Mr. Graper, that last weekend and this weekend were two weekends I just couldn't do it. So I can't be there Saturday. I wish you the best of luck with your CPO event. Appreciate the work. And that's really, I know it's been a long night. It's been a long evening. And the dog and the pooch. So there's Nina. So this is Nina. Now, I had a yellow lab. Her name was Ginger. And so very the same color, yellow lab, beautiful dog. So this kind of comes home to me a little bit. She's an obvious gal, older, easygoing, calm, so sweet and charming to meet. Wouldn't you know, she likes people. She likes them a lot, and it shows. This 10-year-old Labrador is ready to be petted, and all the time would be just fine, ready to relax, ready to join you. She'd be a great family dog, but also a good solo gal for a new solo friend. She is here in her dog by the fireplace pose, just waiting for you. So for more information about Nina and other adoptable dogs, please contact Clackamas County Dog Services at 503-655-8628, www.clackamas.us/dogs. Thank you.
Great. With that, I'll conclude by on a couple issues. One thing is the president's budget ends Meals on Wheels because they said it doesn't do any good. I've been on Meals on Wheels every year for a number of years as a mayor and as a county commissioner. What good doesn't it do? I mean, I'm very confused. And then HUD, I'm really concerned about HUD funds because they sound like they're going to cut the program. And that's very concerning. The other day we gave an award to a Rao teacher who was providing, had organized and provided food for kids at Rao because 70% go hungry. And here we're talking about any Meals on Wheels. I think that as a commission, one of our priorities should be, like you always say, you need a job first. But also, I think it's almost a constitutional right that you should be able to eat. So I think that Clackamas County Commission, one thing we do have the grant program that I'd like to focus on providing food for kids going to school. Because they, when you go home and you don't have food all weekend, it's about Wednesday when you've had school meals and then your brain starts working right. I think it should be a priority. I run a nonprofit that gets funds off the farmers market. That is how we spend our money every year. We donate to feeding programs like Backpack Buddy and stuff like that. I'm very concerned. Planning staff, we were delayed because a lot of people voted for marijuana. I didn't. So it delayed us for 2 years. But when you talk to I agree we need to add more planning staff, but it takes a while. You can't just hire a guy and all of a sudden you got all this staff. But I think we should focus on adding staff over the next few years so we can get caught up. Because I heard somebody mention the population growth by 2030. I just testified today in Salem that it was 300,000. In Clackamas County more by 2030. I was in Salem testifying on the courthouse. We're looking at a courthouse up here and the state's willing to pay half of it. You can't let something like that go by when ours is sliding into the Willamette River. So that's of great concern. Also, I heard today, you know, we're trying to resolve the reserves. Ryan Clem is going to call a committee together with Thousand Friends, myself, and various other groups, not including the cities, to discuss resolving the reserves. I warn people that if we don't do it, the legislature will, and that's what this committee is about. So, of course, I'm hoping that the IGA that we're talking about, the community will get a look at it and make that decision and get on board before somebody else tells us what we're going to do, and then they won't have any say in it. And we are working hard to make sure the communities are heard. Whether they sign it or not, I think that we've made a big effort. We spent 2 hours in Stafford community the other night. I thought it was a great meeting. I appreciate their efforts, their years of work on this. We all support the vision, the goal of preserving what is a great community, but if we don't resolve this, the legislature will. So they want to do this in the next 2 weeks. That's going to be tough to do. But if I have to, I'll spend all my time down there. And hopefully we'll have that IGA sort of finalized before that meeting occurs so I can take it and say, hey, look, we're working hard. Give us some more time. So just want to let you know, I heard that today. Got a message from Chris Lyons. So we'll be trying to arrange that soon. I want to thank you all very much for attending. It was great. I felt it was a kumbaya moment. And we don't have many of those. But thank you very much. Meeting adjourned.